And let me introduce Eleftherios Kokoris Kogias. I hope I've announced your name right. If not, I'm sorry. He's a research scientist at Novi, Facebook, working on decentralized systems, applied cryptography, and distributed computing. Eleftherios will be joining IST Austria as an assistant professor in September 2021 and received his PhD from EPFL and his master's from National Technical University of Athens. His talk, let me find the, his talk's title is Bootstrapping Consensus and MPC in an Asynchronous Network. The stage is yours.
Thank you very much. Can you see my screen? Everything works well?
Yes.
Perfect, thank you. So thank you very much for the introduction. As you said, I'm Eleftherios, or Eleftherios, my actual login name. And I'm currently at Novi, soon joining IST Austria. And this is a talk on asynchronous distributed key generation, which has multiple applications in MPC, consensus, threshold signatures, and a lot of the stuff we're talking in this workshop. So our motivation, because we're a bit more on the practical side, was on how to get scalable consensus algorithms. So if we look into the state of the art, there we can see protocols such as SBFT and Hotstar that are partially synchronous. And in order to be very efficient, they can actually achieve linear communication complexity. They need this trusted setup, bootstrap step. This unfortunately means that if this step is broken, so the dealer that does it leaks a key, then the safety of the system can be broken. This is similar also in the fully asynchronous setting where protocols such as VABA use the same bootstrap assumptions to get efficiency. Of course, they're more inefficient. They like VABA isn't squared, but that's because of other reasons of working in asynchrony. So in our work, we basically saw how to remove this trusted setup and instead add a bootstrapping step that takes n to the fourth in communication complexity. But once you run it at the beginning of the protocol, then we can actually execute the fully efficient protocols in their absolute best. So we can get amortized the same complexity as the ones with trusted setup. We already talked a bit on secret sharing, so I'm not going to go very deep. One thing that I want to introduce is the fact that there is this idea of asynchronous verifiable secret sharing, which is verifiable secret sharing in asynchronous networks, where we don't really know if every party can get the secret from the dealer simply because of asynchrony, we don't see all the messages. So the idea there is to secret share the secret shares so that some slow nodes that at the beginning of the DLN didn't manage to get it, they can actually recover it from the rest of the parties. So once we have this secret sharing, the key question is what are we going to do? And as already introduced at the first talk, one idea is to secret share private keys. And if we secret share private keys, that means that we can generate things such as threshold signatures, which are constant sized even if we have multiple parties signing some statement. And additionally, if we use something like BLS or RSA signatures that are deterministic, these signatures can be used as a random coin, just as we saw at DRAND at the first talk. To get an idea of how this works, if we look at the classic consensus protocol such as PBFT, we have the leader and some parties. The leader asks some of the parties to commit a value. The parties check the value and they send back the signatures that they can commit that value. Then the leader will collect all those signatures in a linear sized array to the number of the parties and will use that as proof to convince everyone that consensus has been reached. In SBFT and Hotstuff, the key idea is that since we have this DLN phase that creates a threshold key, the parties will simply use their secret shares to sign the commitment so that the leader can aggregate those secret shares and generate a constant size proof that the whole group, or 2F plus 1 in the consensus setting, managed to achieve consensus. This, as a result, lowers the communication complexity by an order of n. However, the problem with this setting is that if that key is leaked, then the adversary can generate commitments of whatever value he likes. If he knows the threshold share key, he can sign anything he likes, convince anyone that something is in the consensus, although it is not. So this is not a great case because we really need to trust the dealer. In full asynchrony, we use the same trick, like VABA used the same trick for compaction as before. And additionally, the threshold signature scheme is used to generate what we call a common coin, which is the randomness that is necessary to circumvent the FLP impossibility in order to inject some unpredictability in how the network messages are delivered and be able to probabilistically be live without having any timing assumptions. Although this is really cool, that means that if the trust setup is broken, it's not only the safety that is broken, but it's also the liveness that is broken. And the problem with the liveness being broken is that you cannot really detect that the liveness is broken in a synchronous network. It can just be that the messages are not delivered the correct way. So you're basically stuck and have no way understanding that the problem is someone sees the randomness or simply the network has not converged in the correct way right now. The idea of how to overcome this trusted setup is this distributed key generation that was already described a bit, where since we don't want to have a trusted dealer, what we do is we let everyone be the dealer of some secret key. So party one here is going to generate a secret key, secret sharing with everyone else. Party two is going to do the same, party three the same, party four the same. And once everyone has secret share some key, we can add them up together and say, now we know that the key is not known to any party. So as long as at least one party is honest and has hidden its secret shared key, we can be safe. The challenge comes when we move to asynchrony. There we can have some parties that are malicious or simply crashing. And then we don't really know for which party we're going to wait. Like we know one party might crash, but we don't know exactly which. So different parties are going to wait for different N minus F. And that is a problem because to agree on our distributed key generation, we need to get the secret keys from the same parties. Otherwise we're going to diverge. So it seems like we kind of need consensus to bootstrap consensus. And this is more or less the case. One way to go over it is the work from Anket, Hybrid DKG, where they proposed back in 2009 to run a PBFT variant in order to agree on which subset of parties we're going to use in order to generate our distributed key. Some challenges that still exist after this protocol is, first of all, the fact that it supports an F plus one threshold. And this is problematic for the efficiency gains that we get at hot stuff or VABA that need an N minus F or usually two F plus one threshold in order to do the compaction that we need. And secondly, it assumes partial synchrony. So it would only work if there is this partial synchrony, synchrony assumption. It does not work in full asynchrony. So to solve the first problem, what we did is we looked into what the trusted setup gives us, what properties we get from the trusted setup versus what are the actual needs of consensus. And if you see at this slide, you see that there is a difference here. Both protocols need N minus F parties to participate for liveness. So as I said, that's what hybrid gives it doesn't have and what we want. However, for safety, a trusted setup protocol gives us resilience with up to 2F malicious parties. That means that even if 2F parties are malicious and act arbitrarily, the key is still secure. There cannot be any impersonation. There cannot be any forgery. However, we know already in consensus that the moment you get F plus one malicious parties, the protocol is broken for completely different reasons. So there is no point in trying to protect the key for more than F parties. So the threat models do not match. And this is what inspired the high threshold asynchronous verifiable secret sharing that we introduced. The basic idea of HAVSS is that we separate the safety from the liveness thresholds in order to actually match the needs of the consensus. So in our HAVSS, the key is safe as long as at most F parties are malicious. If we get F plus one malicious parties, the key is completely compromised. The adversary can use it and generate signatures as if the whole group is generating signatures. However, in order for the key to be live, we actually need two F plus one parts to participate. So if we do see a usage of that key, we know that a big enough quorum, a two F plus one quorum actually agreed on something. And that's what Hostaff and SBFT need. The basic idea of HAVSS, which is heavily inspired from the previous AVSS protocols, is to use a bivariate polynomial, but separate the thresholds. So basically what we do is on one dimension, we're secret sharing with a high threshold, with a 2F plus one threshold. But then we're secret sharing the secret shares with a lower threshold. So in our case, with 2 out of 4, we're secret sharing every secret share. However, to actually get the secret, we need 3 out of 4 to participate. Which means that if we try to run such a protocol, then let's say here, party one and party two are honest, party three is malicious, and party four is actually not connected well enough, so they're not participating during the sharing phase. Then when HAVSS terminates, party one and party two are going to have their whole columns and rows. Party three is also going to have it, but they are then not going to participate in order to break our liveness. And we need a way to actually recover the secret. If we only had S1 and S2, we can't recover the secret because we need 3 out of 4 and party three will not reveal a string. However, what happens here is that party one and party two can give the secret share of the secret shares they hold that can help party four with 2 out of 4 to recover its secret share, S4. And then S1, S2, and S4 are enough to actually get the higher threshold that will prove that the 2F plus one quorum in our case agreed or committed the value. So the basic properties of HAVSS is first of all liveness. The fact that if the dealer of the protocol is honest throughout the sharing stage, then all parties will complete the sharing. Some parties will complete it directly, they're going to get it from the dealer, and some parties might actually not get it from the dealer, but later on be able to recover it from the other parties because of the lower threshold. And we also get the agreement property, which says that if some honest party completes the sharing, then all parties will eventually complete the sharing. So even the ones that were slow can get their secret shares at some point. And only using this and plug it into HybridDKG is actually already enough to remove the trust setup assumption from Hotstuff and from SBFT and get a fully decentralized partially synchronous consensus protocol that has a very efficient fast path after the bootstrapping phase. However, this is only the first step of the paper, and I'm going to go a bit more superficially for the rest, where we try to actually achieve a fully asynchronous attribute key generation. So the lower layer is HAVSS. Like in every DKG protocol, every party is going to try and secret share a key. And then we want to run a DKG. However, in full asynchrony, we know that we cannot terminate. There's no way we can terminate because of the FLP impossibility. So what we do is we forfeit this property. We say our DKG actually cannot deterministically terminate. However, it can sometimes be consistent. And when it is consistent, we are going to use it to try and harvest some randomness from it. So basically what we do is every time we think our WDKG is consistent, we have an construction we call it eventually perfect common coin that tries to use this chance of consistency to produce a shared random value for everyone. Of course, because it's only a chance of consistency and not a certainty, it's not deterministic, there can be cases where we actually are wrong or the adversary manipulates it so that we get wrong. However, you'll see that in our protocol, we manage to bound this number of times to only F. So after F failures, we know that we're going to have a strong common coin. The basic idea of WDKG is extremely simple. Basically, every party is going to run an HAVSS, and then they're going to wait and see who else managed to terminate their HAVSS. Once they see at least F plus one successful terminations, they basically just broadcast what they've seen. If they see someone else terminating, they're going to update their prediction to a higher number of parties that correctly terminated their WDKG. So you can have multiple predictions from F plus one up to even 3 F plus one predictions. Then we wait to listen from the other parties what they've seen. And once we get 2 F plus one matching messages, so we get 2 F+1 parties that all have terminated the same set of F plus one to 3 F plus one HAVSSs, we're going to use that as a candidate key. If for some reason later on we see a better candidate key, so here we actually realize that party 4 also managed to terminate its HIVSS, we can update our prediction. With the only limit being that we update predictions only if the key is bigger. So only if the key includes more HIVSS being terminated. So the number of secrets that go in the key only strictly increases. And this is how we can actually bind the number of failures. And the property of why WDKZ works comes directly from the agreement of HIVSS, which says that if I've seen an HIVSS terminated, everyone will have seen that HIVSS terminated at some point in time. I don't know how much, but it will eventually happen, which means that we are going to eventually agree. There's eventually going to be a key that is the same for everyone. I just don't know when that happens. So the basic properties of WDKZ is eventual agreement. The fact that there is going to be some last prediction for everyone, some ultimate key, that is going to be exactly the same. We can achieve consistency before in some intermediate key, and that would be the lucky case. But because we know that there is going to be the ultimate key, we know that eventually we're going to be consistent and be able to produce the same randomness. And the second property is containment, the fact that as I update my keys, every smaller key fully contains the bigger key. So this means that there can be at most F keys, from like 2F+1 sized key to 3F+1 sized key. And every size has a unique set that will be output. As a result, we have a very good bound of how many times we will fail. Then once we have our inverse perfect common coin, we actually use existing constructions more or less. Once we have our inverse perfect common coin, we can plug it into a binary agreement that can withstand some failures. So basically, a binary agreement that uses weak common coins that have only probability of being consistent. And then we will run basically n concurrent binary agreements to get the ADKJ. So to get a bit into how we bound this number of failures to F, let's see an example. So in this example, we have party 1 and party 2 that have a candidate key being key 1. Party 3 is malicious, so it's going to try and break our consistency of the key. And party 4 has key 2. And key 2 is better than key 1, so it has a higher cardinality. So in this case right now, actually the adversary can launch an attack and break the consistency. And how this works is, first, party 3 is going to ask party 1 and party 2 to produce a randomness value for some sequence number. So our binary agreement basically signs sequence numbers, and every sequence number corresponds to a random value that they're going to use to achieve consensus. So party 3 asks party 1 and party 2 to sign a sequence number. The threshold here is 3 out of 4, so party 3 has 2 shares plus its own 3, so it managed to produce a randomness number. We call it rand 1 from key 1 for that sequence number. Then part 3, the adversary actually is going to deliver something new to party 2. It's going to deliver the fact that actually there is a bigger, better key that you can use. So party 2 is going to directly jump into that better key because that's what our algorithm says. So now party 3 can do exactly the same. So it will ask party 2 and party 4, for the same sequence number, use your best key. Since party 2 has updated to a better key, it will participate again. So again, 2 plus 1, 3. Part 3 manages to generate a second random value. And then it can deliver those random values as it likes and completely break any chance of consistency we have on this invocation of that sequence number to achieve consensus. The nice thing though is that this attack cannot happen an infinite number of times, because on the next round, when we have sequence number SQ plus 1, Part 3 will ask Part 1 to use Q1 to sign SQ plus 1. It has its own, that's 2, but there is no third one. So basically key 1 is dead. It can never be used again to produce a random value. And as I already said, we have at most F keys. So this means that this attack can only happen F times. And these are the maximum of F points of disagreement that we have in our protocol. So in the end, once we have this eventually perfect common coin, we can plug it into protocols such as Mustafao Zetala synchronous binary agreement that uses a weak common coin to remove its trusted dealer assumption. And that already becomes an n squared words binary agreement. Of course, that n squared is only amortized because it takes n to the fourth to get the bootstrapping step in there. And once we have binary agreement, we can run n parallel binary agreements. Every binary agreement is basically answering the question, did that party terminate AG vs S correctly? So that means that once we terminate F plus one binary agreements with the output being this party actually did its job correctly, we can then wait to terminate every binary agreement, add up all the AG vs S instances whose binary agreement outputted one, and that's our new distributed key. And this can actually already be a consensus protocol. It takes n to the fourth, it doesn't have trust setup, but the normal way to use it is as the bootstrapping step to those protocols that have a trusted setup and are more efficient. And I think that's it. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Eleftherios. Are there any questions?
So maybe I'll get started. So Lathiris, thanks for the nice talk. One thing which I was not able to immediately understand that when you look at the high threshold AVSs, how that becomes sufficient for hot stuff? So you added a...
It's not about efficiency, it's the fact that...
No, sufficient. Why that is sufficient? Why we don't need the complete DKG there?
Because in hot stuff, the assumption is that F parties are malicious. So HAVSS is secure, right? But for the efficiency gain, hot stuff like the actual threshold secret shared hot stuff needs a 2F plus 1 key. We need this 2F plus 1 key in order to have a constant size message that says 2F plus 1 parties have agreed on something. So that is enough because we get the security of F plus 1. That's what hot stuff needs for security. And we get the compaction of 2F plus 1, which is what hot stuff needs for efficiency.
But the dealer still knows the secret in that case, right?
Okay, of course, you run it together with something like hybrid DKG, so everyone does that same thing, and we add them up, of course.
Oh, okay. So
that is an AVSS that you plug in something like...
Okay.
Yes, of course. Okay.
So one other thing, maybe so if you look at US protocol stack about the high threshold AVSS, can we give some property for that, or what can we call that whole thing by itself? The reason I'm asking is that because somehow now once you got this asynchronous DKG, you can employ that for consensus or all other mechanisms. So, but if we just give away the VSS below and keep everything on top of that, it's a very non-secret sharing. It's a purely distributed computing kind of primitive. So can one think of that as a primitive itself, and what will that be?
So I'm not sure how much this can be generalized because it kind of uses the idea of secret sharing and randomness to harvest the randomness, right? Otherwise, what we would get if we remove the AVSS and we just did reliable broadcast is a set of values that is increasing. So everyone proposes a value, we can see a set F plus one, and we can get this kind of containment property, which can be useful. Like, for example, if we had, let me find the property. No, it's not. So if we didn't need consensus, but we had, for example, commutative operations, this containment property is already enough because we know that if you've output something, it will always be there. Any future output will only add to that. Of course, in consensus, there could be conflicting, so it doesn't help. But if everything is commutative, there's no conflict, so it can be useful.
Yeah. So the reason I was asking this question, it sounds It was very interesting to see that the somehow DKG is a weaker primitive as compared to consensus in that sense, right? We can go from there to from DKG to consensus, but probably going from other way around in a completely asynchronous setting is what you're addressing here, right? I was curious, what can, if there is some kind of a terminology, what can be employed for that part?
So, of course, if we have consensus, we can solve DK. Consensus and secret sharing, we can solve DK.
But then you see that as a chicken and egg problem, right?
My feeling is that for at least the cryptographic setting, they could be equivalent. Like if you can solve one, you can solve the other. Because if you have DKG, you have randomness, you have consensus, a single consensus. And if you have a single consensus, you get DKG.
Oh yeah, no, that is clear. But here you can achieve DKG without doing consensus, right?
Yes. Yeah.
So that's how you're breaking cycle.
Yes, yes.
So that's something I was very curious.
So basically I think the key idea is that just like also in binary agreement, we don't need this very strict one-shot property that consensus have, like correct or wrong. We actually can fail sometimes as long as we recover from that failure, as long as we remain safe.
Okay, if there are no questions, then we can move to the next call. Thanks a lot, Eleftherios, for the interesting talk.